Magna Story Sound presents an unabridged recording of The Runaway Wife, written by Rosie Clarke, read by Laura Kirman. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Magna. Chapter 1. Would he be there that evening? Annabel Tarleton wondered as she discarded yet another of her dresses and selected one she had earlier rejected as having been worn too often in the past. Yet what did it matter if the evening gown was last season's? She did not suppose he would be there for one moment, and she wasn't likely to meet anyone else in the least interesting. It would be the same crowd as usual, and she would be bored long before the evening was out. In fact, if she thought about it, she didn't particularly want to go. She gave herself a long, critical look in the cheval mirror, turning all ways to see her reflection. She supposed the dress she was wearing would do for the Munsters' dance at a pinch. The cut and style were good, for it had come from the House of Worth and had been expensive when new, but she had worn it more than a dozen times already. However, there was absolutely no chance of her having anything new for the foreseeable future, nor would she dream of asking her brother for money at such a time. Just as she had almost decided to change again, the bedroom door opened and her younger sister came in.
"Mother sent me to see if you were ready," Hetty Tarleton said. "Tom and Selina have arrived. They're having a sherry in the library, but he wants to get off because they encountered some patchy fog on the way here."
"Jonah told me it was going to be a bad night," Annabel said, and pulled a face at her reflection. The dress was last season's, and nothing was going to change that. Though she'd added some silk flowers to the bodice, and her evening shawl was new, a birthday present from Selina Manners, Tom Brocklehurst's sister. Oh, what did it matter?
"Is it bad out, Hetty? Look for yourself. It seems to be coming thicker now."
Annabel turned to glance out of the window, and sure enough, the mist had begun to swirl about the flat countryside surrounding Tarleton Towers.
"How does Jonah know these things, and why does he forecast gloom and doom all the time?"
"That's our Jonah for you," Hetty laughed, her face lighting with mischief.
As children, they had all enjoyed tormenting their long-suffering gardener, and she was secretly rather fond of him. She thought Annabel was too, though she wouldn't have admitted it.
"I think he tries to live up to his name."
"That's quite possible." Annabel cast her eyes upwards and then sighed. "I look awful in this wretched dress, but I suppose it will have to do. Mary Hadley knocked wine over my best one at the last bash, and it's still being cleaned. I doubt if the stain will come out."
"Now you sound just like Jonah," Hetty said and pulled a face.
Annabel's evening bag lay on the bed, its contents spilled out on the cover. She picked up a pretty silver compact, which their brother had bought at Liberty of London as a birthday present for Annabel, and replaced it in the silk evening purse, together with a lace handkerchief.
"You look gorgeous as usual, Belle, and no one will care if you've worn the dress before. You're so lucky to be going to yet another dance. I just wish I could go to one."
Annabel glanced at her sister and smiled. Hetty's hair was darker and thicker than her own, a honey blonde, similar to Lady Tarleton's, rather than the fine, spun gold Annabel had been blessed with. Her brother Benedict's colouring was a match for hers, but then they were twins, alike in many ways, and not just in looks. Hetty took after her mother, and was generally thought not to be as pretty as her sister, though she had a wide, generous mouth and a lovely smile. Annabel thought her sister was like a young colt, all long legs and tossing hair.
"Your turn will come, Poppet," Annabel said. "Another couple of years, that's all. I shall be married off by then, and hopefully you'll be able to have more clothes than I have. If my husband is rich, I'll spend some of it on you, and that's a promise." "I'm not sure I care much about clothes."
"You will,"
Annabel said. She dropped a kiss on her sister's head in passing. "When I marry a rich man, I'll take you shopping and buy you lots of lovely things."
"Just as long as you marry someone you care about," Hetty said, looking at her with anxious eyes. "Ben was telling me he intends to marry for money. He says he doesn't care if she looks like a horse, as long as she comes with a fat settlement."
"Ben has a large house in danger of falling down around him," Annabel said. "The poor darling has to marry a fortune or sell the estate.
He should have sold all father's investments after he died, but he was too young to understand what was going on, and father's lawyers told him it would be best to leave the money where it was until he was ready to deal with it himself. It had been bad advice, as it turned out, though well-intentioned. Their father had invested most of his money in America, and when the Wall Street crash came in October 1929, it had taken most of what they had. Benedict Tarleton was still reeling from the shock of being told he had virtually nothing, other than the estate itself, and was desperately trying to save himself from bankruptcy.
"That would be a bit of a shame," Hetty admitted. She loved the big, shabby, rather ugly old house for all its faults and inconveniences, and knew that she would hate to see it sold. And yet she wanted her brother to be happy. "But Ben should find some other way to make his fortune."
"Father lost most of our money trying to make his fortune. Everything seemed to be booming when he bought all those shares. It would have been much safer in land, but he wanted a better return for us all," Annabel said, a sad expression in her deep blue eyes. It was the constant worry about money that had brought on the illness, which had led, a year or so earlier, to her father's sudden death at the age of 53. "Ben will make up his own mind what he's going to do, but Mother wants him to marry Helen Winters because of the money her grandfather left her, and he probably will when it comes to it."
"I still think he should wait until he falls in love. He might fall for a rich girl as easily as a poor one."
"Perhaps he will." Annabel picked up her shawl. "I haven't got time for this, Hetty. Tom will be getting impatient." Hetty watched as she left the room and then went over to the dressing table to borrow a spray of perfume from the pretty cut glass bottle. The perfume was French and expensive and had been a present from Major Brocklehurst on Annabel's 20th birthday in June. He had given Hetty something similar for her own birthday in the spring. She liked Tom and Selina. They were distant cousins and had been good to the family since Sir William's death. It was to Tom that Ben had turned for advice, after the shock of the crash, though he had refused to accept a loan, mainly because he knew that Tom would never allow him to repay it. And Selina was the reason Annabel had been invited to so many parties and dances. She was a widow, quite well off, and had a large circle of friends she entertained both in London and at her brother's country house.
"I've no one else but you," she told Hetty's mother once when Hetty was in the room. "Your children and my brother are my family. If I can be of help to the girls, it will be a pleasure."
"You're so kind, Selina." Lady Tarleton had taken full advantage of the offer. "If you could just introduce Annabel to some of your friends, I'm sure something can be arranged for her, even though she is a difficult girl to please." Hetty knew their mother wanted Annabel to make a good marriage. In her own opinion, she thought Belle was beautiful, intelligent, and good-natured, so it ought to be easy to find her a rich husband. She suspected that Tom Brocklehurst was a little in love with her himself, though at past 40, he was perhaps too old and set in his ways to be considered a good catch. Yet Hetty thought, if it were her, she would rather marry him than most of the young men who came courting her sister. Having helped herself to Annabel's perfume, she began to tidy away the clothes her sister had discarded, holding the ones she liked up against her figure. She didn't know why Belle was in such a fuss over the dance. It was surely no different from any of the others. Annabel's heart missed a beat as she caught sight of him across the room, her stomach clenching with nerves. She'd been so sure he wouldn't be here this evening. He seldom attended little dances like this, because he was more often in London or at Newmarket for the racing. They had met on only one other occasion, and she'd felt an instant attraction, though she wasn't certain he was interested. He'd smiled, asked her to dance, talked about his passion for racehorses, briefly mentioned the business passed on to him by his late father, and then left her to rejoin his friends. Tall and lean, with dark hair and an attractive face, Richard Hansen was very wealthy. Everyone knew that he was the heir to a vast manufacturing empire. His grandfather had started with some mills in the North Country, but his father had expanded the business and had become both wealthy and influential. Richard had been sent to the best schools and then to Oxford, where he had somehow...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.